Hi, thanks for joining us for today's video on Unified DLP in Microsoft 365. I'm Moss Libman, a Principal Program Manager on the Microsoft Information Protection team, and today I'm going to talk to you a bit about how to deploy and configure our Endpoint Data Loss Prevention solution. Unified DLP is an integral component of our Microsoft 365 Information Protection Suite that gives you broad visibility and control over the lifecycle of your sensitive information as it's used and shared by your users across your organization. While our data loss prevention solution works across various different cloud services, for today's video, we're going to talk specifically about our endpoint data loss prevention capabilities. Here I've opened the Microsoft 365 Compliance Center. That's your one-stop shop to manage all of your information protection and data governance needs across Microsoft 365. This includes tools like communications compliance, insider risk management, and of course, data loss prevention. But for today, we're going to zoom into the data classification section first to show you how out of the box, from the moment that you've deployed Endpoint DLP to your devices, you get immediate visibility into how and where sensitive data is being used from and on those devices. Here I've opened the Activity Explorer in the Compliance Center, where I can see a histogram of various different types of activity related to sensitive files that have been used and shared on my endpoint devices. Now this data is flowing in right out of the box from the moment that I've onboarded these devices, so I haven't even turned on a policy yet to start protecting the data, and I'm already getting visibility into how and where sensitive data has been used by my users on this new place where I've just started to protect my sensitive information. Using the controls built into the Activity Explorer, it's super easy for me to be able to pinpoint specific types of risky activity and to filter through the thousands of different activities that may be related to certain circumstances that I'm not particularly interested in looking at today. As you can see, I've zoomed in the view here to show specific types of activities that occur on endpoint devices. In this case, I can see a spike of activity that occurred around the 19th of August. And if I hover over that, I can see that there were roughly 5,400 sensitive files that were copied to a network share. That's a potentially suspicious activity that I want to look into more and ensure that sensitive data is being used properly under these circumstances. Here I've gotten the histogram out of the way so I can pinpoint and look at all of the different activities that fed into that histogram that we were looking at earlier. So I can select specific activities and really see the details about what generated that audit telemetry. Here we can see a variety of information about an activity related to sensitive data that was copied to a network share. I can see the machine, the username, the file path that the data originated from. I can even see the specific types of sensitive data that were detected in the file when that activity was performed. And this gives me immediate visibility so I can really ensure and understand how are my users using sensitive data and do I have the right policies in place to ensure that it's not being used improperly. To turn on those controls and to ensure that data on my endpoint devices is being used properly, we're going to switch on over to the Data Loss Prevention section of the Microsoft 365 Compliance Center. Here I've opened the Data Loss Prevention homepage where I can see all of the policies that I use to manage my data loss prevention controls across my organization. To start with, we're going to zoom in to the endpoint DLP settings so we can see some of the ways that you can fine-tune the behavior of DLP on your Windows 10 devices. On the Endpoint DLP settings page, I can adjust and fine-tune the behavior of my Endpoint DLP controls as they're running on my managed devices. This includes adjusting the paths upon which sensitive data is automatically scanned for. For example, I may want to exclude my application data path, which includes a variety of different temporary files and content that is not generally subject to the policies that I'm concerned with. I can also adjust which applications are allowed to access sensitive data as deemed by my DLP policy controls that I'll show you in just a moment. In addition to controlling which places you want to exclude from your scan results or the specific applications that you want to prevent from accessing your sensitive data, you can also choose the specific browsers or third-party services where you want to prevent sensitive data from being egressed through your custom DLP policy controls that we'll show you in just a moment. We also get additional controls such as fine-tuning the behavior of the business justification dialog users will see when their activities are restricted by a DLP policy in your organization. let's go ahead and switch on over to the DLP policy configuration experience so we can show you how that works. Here I'm back on the Data Loss Prevention homepage with the Policies tab open, and we're going to show you how to create a policy to protect sensitive data on your endpoint devices. Out of the box, our data loss prevention solution provides a variety of templates and built-in sensitive types that make it super easy for you to get started protecting common types of sensitive information, whether it relates to medical regulations, privacy regulations, or other different type of regulatory data. Here we're going to go ahead and pick the PCI DSS policy template that will help me set up a policy to protect credit card data and other types of financial PII data in my organization. Once I've chosen the starting template that I want to use for this policy, I can give it a name that will help my organization understand the purpose or intent of this policy control for my organization. The next step in configuring a DLP policy is to choose the places or locations where you want to protect sensitive data. Now, by default, as you can see here, we've selected all of the different locations that you can protect from a policy, including Exchange, SharePoint, OneDrive, even third-party cloud services are included here in this policy control. But for today, we're going to zoom into the endpoint data loss prevention section. So we're going to show you a policy that's specifically configured for endpoint devices. After selecting the locations I want to protect in this policy, I can now choose to either stick with the defaults that were included in the template, or I can fine-tune the specific types of sensitive data that will be protected in this policy. Here we can see that by default, credit card numbers with a high confidence level have automatically been configured in this policy by definition of the template that I chose earlier. But if I'd like, I can actually choose and add additional types of sensitive information to this policy. For example, I could choose to add any of our built-in sensitive information types as additional corroborative evidence. Or I could choose a sensitivity label that my organization uses to pinpoint financial data so that I can include that signal as a control in this policy. The next step in your policy configuration is to choose the outcomes that you want to occur when that sensitive data is detected. And you have a variety of controls here to choose how many sensitive information types must be detected, as well as the ability to turn on administrative alerts to inform your data administrative staff when suspicious activity has occurred or when a policy has been violated. You can configure an alert to trigger immediately the moment a single instance is detected, or you can turn on aggregated alerts. An aggregated alert is a powerful way for you to pinpoint potentially suspicious or risky activity by reasoning across the circumstances that occur over a time span. For example, I may want to pinpoint or generate an alert to my administrative staff when I see a large volume of sensitive information being printed to a printer, or potentially a high amount, megabytes of data being copied to a USB drive. And through these controls, I can choose how many instances, how many circumstances, what volume of data that I want to trigger this alert from. Now that I've configured this policy to notify my administrative staff through an alert, I can now choose what types of restrictions or activities are applied directly on the endpoint devices when a given risky activity has taken place. For example, I can see a number of different specific type of activities, such as copying to a network share, or copying to clipboard, or copying data to a network share, as specific types of activities that I can control. And within each of these controls, I have options to either monitor and audit when this activity occurs, or I can turn on proactive controls to either block the user from performing the operation when it's detected with sensitive data, or to block but allow them to override the operation. Now, Blockwith Override is a very powerful option that allows you to put into place your policy controls to ensure sensitive data is used properly, but give your end users an out, allow them to continue to be productive if they have a valid business use for that data. And by integrating this policy override experience directly into our Windows 10 DLP policy experience, users get a native and real-time ability to interact with those policy controls. And of course, all behind the scenes, all of the audit telemetry and detection telemetry continues to feed in to the Activity Explorer. So you get that visibility across any of the times these activities have occurred. Here, I've configured this policy to block users from sharing sensitive data to third-party cloud services or accessing that sensitive data from an unallowed browser that doesn't understand our Endpoint DLP policy. I've also turned on block override restrictions for other types of activities, so that if a user is performing a function such as copying data to a USB device, they'll be able to override that activity if they have a business need. Now that I've finished configuring my policy, I get to choose whether I want to turn it on right away or if I want to use our test feature. Test is a very powerful option that allows you to get started very easily and quickly with turning on your DLP policy controls without needing to worry about affecting or impacting the productivity of your end users. This gives you that what-if data so that you get an immediate understanding of what would happen if you turned on this policy so that you can fine-tune the controls, adjust the places and ways that the limits are in place, and assure that the policy that you're going to turn on and affect your end users is precisely pinpointed to the circumstances and data types that you would like to protect. After configuring the policy and validating that all of the information that I've selected is appropriate, I can go ahead and submit this into the system. And after roughly 1 hour, all of the places that I've configured in this policy will begin to enforce the new settings that I've applied. Next, we're going to show you what the experience on a Windows 10 device looks like when users are interacting with sensitive data that's subject to one of the policy controls we just showed you. Here I am logged on to my Windows 10 managed desktop that's subject to the organization's DLP policy controls that I just showed you a moment earlier. And here I have access to a variety of sensitive files that I happen to have stored locally directly on this Windows 10 device. For example, here I have Project Obsidian, a specification for a new engine chip design that's subject to the policy controls I just showed you a moment earlier. Here I have the Project Obsidian specification open that contains the sensitive information that's subject to the DLP policy controls that I just showed you a moment earlier. Here, as the user tries to copy the information from this document, because it's subject to the DLP policy restrictions that we just showed you a moment earlier, the user sees a native notification using the standard Windows 10 notification experience to inform them in a familiar way that the information that they're working on and the activity that they're trying to perform is subject to a DLP policy restriction. Now, this policy was configured with the block override option, so the user actually has an option to override or allow the action so that they may copy the data if they so choose. And of course, this data, the telemetry from all of these activities, continues to flow back up into the Activity Explorer, so you get visibility when and how and where users are interacting with your policy restrictions. Next, we have that same product specification open. However, in this case, we're trying to print the document. And as you can see, we get a familiar and consistent notification. So once users see these notices and understand their implications, it's an easy pattern for them to learn and adjust their behavior. In this example, I've taken that same sensitive file and I'm trying to copy it to a USB device. However, in this case, because my policy has restricted and outright blocked copying sensitive data to a USB device, I don't get any options to override the operation, and I'm completely blocked from copying the data because it's sensitive and the policy control stated I don't have an alternative. Another important capability of our Endpoint DLP solution is to ensure that the sensitive data that your users are accessing doesn't egress to the wrong cloud services. And that's achieved through a combination of both our browser restrictions and our integration into Edge Chromium browser. So to start with, I'm going to open up Project Obsidian. This is a copy of the file I just showed you earlier. However, in this case, it's a PDF version of the document. It contains sensitive data, and it's blocked from being shared with a third-party cloud. Now, in this case, I'm going to try and open it with a third-party browser, in this case at Google Chrome, and to show you, because this file contains sensitive data that is subject to the controls that we showed you a moment earlier, DLP will assure that Chrome or any of the unallowed browsers that you've configured will be prevented from accessing the sensitive file. So here you can see we've tried to open up that file in Chrome, and it gives an error stating Chrome is unable to access the file, and we see that familiar notification to inform and educate the user that what they're doing is subject to a policy control. And we even see a tip that informs them that they may try opening this document up in Edge Chromium because Edge Chromium is enlightened with our DLP policy controls and will assure that the data is used properly while not getting in the way if they're not trying to do anything that violates your policy controls. So let's go ahead and show you what it looks like to open up that exact same document in Microsoft Edge. Now here you can see, because all I'm doing is trying to view the document locally, it's not trying to egress the data in any way that violates my policy. Edge understands this, allows me to see the data and interact with it. But it knows our policy. Edge understands the restrictions that are applied to this content. So if I happen to perform an operation, such as copy it to the clipboard, Edge is going to jump right in and tell me natively within the Edge experience that this operation is subject to my organization's policy controls and I can't perform it. Of course, as we saw earlier, this policy control is a block override control. So the user gets an out. They can click yes in this case and override the policy control and copy the data if they need to. Now let's switch over to one of the cloud services that we showed earlier that's restricted from accessing or being shared any of the sensitive data that is subject to the policies that we showed earlier. So in this case, we're going to show you what it looks like when we try to copy that same Project Obsidian document to my Slack forum. Now, as you can see, the moment that I try to copy this file, Edge Chromium pinpoints and understands that this file is subject to the policies that we showed you earlier, that copying it and uploading it to this location is not allowed, and I see a policy notification that prevents me from performing that operation. Now that we've shown you some of the ways that users see and interact with the end user notification experience of our Endpoint DLP policy experience, let's circle back now and show you how some of the telemetry that we just showed you appears in the Activity Explorer. Here I've gone back to the data classification section of the Activity Explorer in the Microsoft 365 Compliance Center. And here I can see that same list of activities that we showed you earlier relating to a variety of different suspicious activities that are occurring from my endpoint devices. And here we can see a specific file, Project Obsidian spec.pdf, that we were showing you earlier as users tried to print and copy that content. So here I can see that the activity file printed was detected by our policy, and I can zoom in to find out a variety of different insights about that activity, the username that performed it, the type of printer that it was printed to, or the name or the IP address of the system that performed the operation. I can even zoom in and see specific details about the sensitive data that was detected in that file. I can see how many different project terms in this case were detected in the content, as well as other financial data. I can even see the confidence level of each of those detections. So I can precisely understand the detection that occurred and take an appropriate remediation action for this detection. So in summary, I hope you now understand how to better turn on controls to protect the sensitive data that is exploding and expanding across your organization. As users collaborate and produce more and more sensitive content, it's vital that you have the right controls to give you that visibility to understand where and how it's being used, and of course, to put in those proactive policies to restrict activity to assure that it's happening at the appropriate times. And through the Activity Explorer and through our policy controls, you get that broad visibility so that you can understand and pinpoint, are your users doing the right thing? Do you need new controls to put into place? Do you need new data classifiers to identify new types of sensitive data? All of this comes together through the Microsoft 365 Compliance Center with our unified DLP solution. Now we do have a variety of links shared here for resources that you can find online to help get started with our Microsoft Information Protection solutions, as well as links to a variety of different developer documentation and other resources depending upon your specific needs. We also have a Yammer forum with an active set of both our team from the product group as well as customers using and proactively using the solution. We'd love for you to come join the conversation and share your feedback as you use and deploy our solutions. And with that, thank you for joining us for the video today, and have a great day.